Okay, I'm Peter Rosbach, I'm the founder of the Bee, and I will introduce our experience that we do on container software supply chain. We are not working with every software, we all put things in containers. We don't like push something to machines. Before we do things on machines, we put it in containers. If we have an installation, we put it in containers. That is why we think about rethinking your supply chain software that you really need. It's not made for everything. It's made for containers. And Nicholas, my colleague, and I want to tell us some stories about what we are currently experiencing. What we see is a landscape to build containers. And if you build containers, you have a source code repository, and that is the truth of everything. You must check in everything. And after this check-in, you can go to an automate to build your results. And you need some package artifacts or things, mirrors from the internet world. If you don't have mirrors in your thing and build it from the internet directly, then you can't have repeatable builds. It's not trusted. And all things that you build are pushed to a container registry. And after these steps, all the integration and test environments that you need pull the results from these container registries. And that is the only thing that they pull. And you can trust your own container registry. Who is pull or use in production an image directly loaded from the Docker Hub? Nobody is in production? I think you do that. And that is a fault. It's also a fault in your development environment. It's for prototyping, it's okay, but it's not okay only for create a real value-generated chain. And after this integration step is verified, you have a deployment. And before you can do a deployment, you must promote your image in another container registry. It is running in production. And you must have one registry trusted in your development environment, another one in your staging environment or in production environment. You must promote those images. You cannot directly access or control the rights that you set up in your development environment, and it's the same for your production environments. Don't do that. That is the things what we see is a minimal container pipeline. Supply chain management is a very old thing, and it's not only technical based. It is more, if you like to Google a little bit in Wikipedia, supply chain is a system of organization, people, activities, information, resources involved in moving a product or service from a supplier to a customer. And that means you really ship a thing. And that is what I think. If you have one registry on your development environment, you must ship it to another one that you really use. You are the supplier, and the other thing is the customer. And we are saying, okay, we define container supply chain definition is also a container supply chain is a system of organization, people, activities, information, and resource involve a moving, a containerized application from your local system to a cargo system. It's really a move, a promotion. It's not only a reference. You ship products. And that are really what I think container do for you. We all build those simple systems. I think we have a load balancer, microservice architecture, and a lot of databases behind that. And what we don't see in the first movement is, oh, we must set up those registry. We must have a software that we can deploy those systems. We must need monitoring, logging, matrix, HLC. We must have control a system of batches that like generates backup for the databases or whatever you need on time schedule. And that is a very complex system. Most of you see, okay, this is a complex system. The real truth is this is a complex system. Everything you do here is generate data here, more data than you generate here. And the most of my setups, the monitoring systems, are high loaded, not the real application. You do analyze on all your systems data that you don't do in your real production system. And you must have a clever choose of these systems, and you must set up all those systems. An environment for container systems are more complex systems as I've seen before. It's more parts. What you really need, what we all really need, we want build automatic builds. We want test and deploy container images. We want use base images. I hope you are inspired of trusted and to speed up development. We need blocks that we can use other software. What we also need, we won't not supply a new software on old stacks. We must have a movement to new stable container releases every time. We heard it a lot of talks before. We must ship image with no secure issues inside it. We must use the catalog of images. We won't fail fast. If the new things are failed, the new change failed, we won't after 10 seconds or so to know that and correct that. And we want to validate the correct software. Who's involved to test-driven infrastructure? Who can you do that? Test your infrastructure. Really? The complete infrastructure? All your containers? Who knows server spec? Some of you say, okay, you test your containers and you don't know server spec. Okay, it's a hint. Look deeply inside it. And you must have a clear vision of our continuous delivery and deployment of your software, we heard very often, and to allow our incremental change in production. What you really need is to create a system, a pipelining system to our fast delivery feedback cycle. You have your DevOps team, you have a repository, you build your normal system with build test and validate that, have a short feedback that your images are really built. Then you promote your artifact to your test environments and promote it to your staging environment and promote it to your production, but you need feedback. Is it really true what I deploy? It's failed. It has some mistakes inside it. The load after a change is not okay. It's create a lot of more investment. A simple software container supply chain is easy. You can read it in every book. You have a build tool, compile unit test, build containers, tech containers, push it, or have a deployment or a descriptor like Docker Compose and pull these images from the stage environment and all is working. That's the easy thing. But now, Niklas, tell us the truth.
This came up. Probably not the complete truth. So first of all, the first step we did do is to build images. And with building images, we could use several tools, for example. In this case, we use GitLab CI. We're using several separated runners. For example, we could use Docker to build our machines or our images, or using Docker Machine to build our applications, or using directly Kubernetes with own pods to build it, like Thomas said before in the talk. You could also use the Docker Socket runner, or in GitLab the possibility is there that only pods will be created to build the application. Here's a little example of a GitLab CI pipeline that builds a Docker image. So first of all, we see here a before script that will make the registration to the registry going through there. And after this, we have separated build steps to build the master image and to build the normal image from the master branch, or building images on the master on the branch name, every branch except the master branch. So these are typical build cases that we could use. So also there's a sample application that we try to build would be a Go application. In this case, we use a multi-stage build, building our Go application, wrap it in directly into a static binary, and then we can use the special Docker from scratch. So that's only the application and the required dependencies, in this case, the default SSL certificates to start the application. So we get a very, very thin build. Now, what we could also do is we got some problems here with the dint. The problem is because every time a service restarts, all images need to be pushed again or need to be pulled again. So for that case, instead of building every images with all layers new, we could use something that is called a cache. We could use directly during the Docker image build a cache. And with this, we pull in the latest image from the current branch to receive the latest only to build the difference to the stage before. So one big point is there that is it's only currently the cache from the key is only available in Docker 3.2 and not in the second version of Docker Compose, which is, it's quite disturbing. So also here's the direct example. Instead of reusing it in a GitLab CI pipeline, so we define our current image with a current git tag as example to get traceable builds and also the CI image branch tag to get tracking of the image tag. So then we can say Docker Compose pull to pull the app cache, and then after that we can use Docker Compose build to build the application. After this, we are going tagging it and pushing it again to the new image registry. So what are also some problems or what is a little bit different, there are several ways where we can organize our container project. So for this case, we could build a single image per project. That means we have one Docker file in a project, or we could build a complex software with multi-stage build like we saw before with the Go application, or afterwards we could use multiple Docker files and use the build pattern to build a small thin image, or also there's the possibility to use building a family of images, for example, using multiple versions of Apache Tomcat in one repository. There's also what is also very often on the found on GitHub is that there's a big monorepository that contains multiple projects, like Jesse Frizzell, who does all his Dockerfile in one repository, and then she uses Jenkins to build every images. So what are currently the best practices to create good images? In our opinion, is to create one container for one responsibility and one process only, if it's technically working. Some applications need more than one process. Every time you should log to the standard output or to the standard error so that the orchestrator of a logging framework behind can take the work for you. Also, include a server self-check in your applications, not in your applications, into the Docker file if you're using Docker only, or using the liveness and the readiness in Kubernetes. Try to reduce a minimal content via one layer. When you have the ability, use multi-stage. When you are not having the new Docker version, then use the normal Docker build pattern. After this, don't save any secrets or credentials directly in your image. Mount them through the runtime or have a process to that runs during the runtime to get the secrets and credentials in your images during the container. You should also try to reduce the creation and the startup time of container. That means handling the signals correctly and trying to optimize the start process so that the orchestrator can get a little faster pace in there. Also, think about a graceful shutdown. Not every application can be receive the term directly and say, hey, okay, I'm fine, I'm going down now. Some process needs some time to be get downgraded again. Also, use only trusted sources from your company and don't use the Docker Hub if you want to try to grow in an environment that should be maintained by yourself or some of your colleagues. So now what I want to tell is to talk about secure builds, secure build images. What this means, the secure is in quotes. It's only one of my opinions and Peter's that we currently found at the moment. We are interested in more things that we could do. So the previous what we saw was one in the GitLab CIML is that we need to use a Docker dint, and he needs privileged rights that he can start up. And the problem with the dint is that we don't have the image cache, but this could be solved with an app cache. But the biggest problem is that the build isn't repeatable directly because we're using only the tag. It could be mutable sometimes, and tag could be composite this. And instead of use an image digest if it's working, and if you are using images with distributions like Alpine, Debian, or something else, then try to set up a package mirror to save all the packages that you want really to use, that you are able to build your applications without internet. Also, you need to take control of the GitLab runner so that not every runner can get access to every system. And try to clean up your things so don't get your branches really, really long stale. So what's currently new, when we try to build applications now with the Linux gateway, is we have our normal Docker application or Docker image. It's in case the same Golang application. What we now have, we have a separated Docker file. It's called now Dockerfile artifact. And the new cool thing is that you could use, for example, you can say, hey, I want to use this image as a direct artifact. I save all the sources and all binaries dependencies currently in one image, push it to a registry, and then you can say in a new image, hey, I want to copy. And using the from, then you can reference an image again. So you don't need to get your sources directly from the system. And with this, we have repeatable builds. And this could be also one way how to build your applications in a good manner. When we are looking at into the shell, it will be say, okay, I will build the Dockerfile. He's trying to pull the new the image from the Dockerfile because it doesn't exist at the moment. But he saw only some layers already existing, only two layers got changed. And after this, the build goes further like before. So also, what is currently should be done, that the GitLab runner we are currently using to build our application should not be get accept every image that they want to use. What you also try is to sign images, but signing images is not so easy. Notary is not straightforward. It's the current first implementation to sign your images. And only use trusted registries, so your own company registry, not the Docker Hub. So here's an example of a Docker Compose, of a GitLab runner config that only allows images that comes from the my registry. And we are allowing only images from the Docker Hub now with Go to build some Go applications. And also we could define the services. So services will be linked to the current image and that could be integrated. So you could change here now by default only everything to your local registry, to your trusted registries. And so the GitLab runner didn't have any access to any remote images. Also, what you could set is the pull policy so that not every time the image will be pulled. Important point is that allowed images and allowed services by default wildcarded, so every image can be downloaded from the GitLab runner. So a second point is what you could also use. You could write a special GitLab runner to use only building Docker images. So here in this case, we say we allow only the images from the Docker Hub for building Docker images. But we could also save a policy. In this case, it's empty. It's equals never. So with this, we say, okay, I don't want to pull any images. It's only the images that's currently on the machine. Existence. So we have a process to moving the images to the virtual machine where the GitLab runner is, and after this we could use this to building Docker images by a controlled source. A bigger scope of this is would be to use the normal GitLab CI using an LDAP server that is currently making the authentication for the GitLab CI and also for the Docker engine. The Docker engine has support for authentication, and for this case you could use the Harbor Master or in self-implementation. Some examples by this would be from Nicolas Delouf. He works also for CloudBees. So finally, he did an implementation for the authorization in Go. And with the steps with the Docker runner that we reduce the privilege, we have the option also as well. And try to clean up the things that we are going back. Okay. The second way after we build it in a secure manner is that that we are want to try to distributing our images. And with this case, we come into image promotion. Image promotion means to distribute your container images on a defined criteria. So with this case, it's like an image promotion criteria can now be something that should be matched through a policy that the image can be transferred to a new registry or anyone else get access to this image. Some image promotion criteria would be the tag name, if a tag name contains only valid characters, or we got several vulnerabilities. After this, the images should not be deployed, or the compliance will be checked with the licenses. Only packages should be used that the license will be applied to our system, to our company, or using the quality, for example, that the image will pass the Docker lint and no style guide will be threatened. Also, you could use as a promotion criteria the size, or checking the Docker image, the base image, that it's only come from your local company. In this picture, I will switch on it. Wait. I hope for see it. Okay. Hopefully you can see it. It's from Anchor.io. It's a cloud service, and with this, it comes now in the new hell when you're doing image promotion. Because now you set up policies that contains on different cases. For example, in this case, I said, okay, my Docker image doesn't have a package aptitude to install packages after the image gets deployed. Or checking that no secrets are in there. Or don't allow that the port 22 will be exposed. For this, you could use Anchor.io, for example. Also, what Anchor.io supports is to mapping these policies to several images. So there are a lot of different strategies to promote this image. The first of all we saw was completely with a normal tagging. So we take our image with a git tag, and the image will be pushed to the distributor, in this case our registry, and the registry drops the notifications, will make then the checks for the policies. And then after it will deny it or not during the process of uploading it. Also, the possibility is to promote an image to a different registry, so in that case we're using Harbor to push our image to Harbor, I will come later to that, and then we are going, instead of pushing it to the normal GitLab registry. Yeah, so the Harbor registry is a little complex registry, so we got the Harbor admin server, and then we see that we are have the possibilities to scan images or using Notary to sign our images also. With vulnerability scanning we have Claire. And with Claire, we're gonna could scan our Docker images on vulnerabilities or public vulnerability databases. If you want to extend it, Clearbit's also the possibility. So here we see Harbor in action. I checked HTTPD in a... Oh, it's not so... I hope... Wait, we'll switch. Yeah, I would... I move to this. Okay. Hopefully, I see no... No, I got no connection. Okay. Wait, I would... No, it doesn't scale with me. Ja, ich habe Displays geöffnet. Ah. Let's see. Okay. Going back to... Ah, komm. Okay, in this case we see here now we have several vulnerabilities and also Harbor says the packages will be deployed. We have also the option to say, hey, my image has some security leaks, I don't want to push that anyone get access to this image anymore and the Harbor will deny the access to the image. Also, we could define in the Harbor the vulnerability scanning on every push for an image. Yeah, also here's a check of an artifact. So this is our Golang application that I pushed before into the Harbor. And after this, here's the special application now. And here comes where the CVE checks don't will grab anymore. So for this case, it's so that we are going, seeing only that no vulnerabilities could be found because it's only the static binary in the container. So normal CVE EVA checks will don't pass anymore. Yeah. So to create a trust chain of images, it's so that we need to check CVE before we want to try to push a registry. It would be recommended to set up a trash registry where it could be all images from everything. And images should be checked after the database gets updated. Try to use daily builds to update your images on a daily frequency. If you want to do it on runtime, it will be really hard because you need to manage a dependency graph. And dependency graph management is not so quite easy. Try to sign your images, notary is not quite easy as well. And use a package mirror. Use only trusted container images from your system. Try to build your images without free internet access that you know that you could be also when you get an attack or something else that you can be able to reproduce your infrastructure on a fast pace. Use only automated deployment pipelines. Don't do it by your hand. It's too risky that something goes wrong. And don't patch. Try to create it from scratch again instead of using it directly again. And do a separation of content with a registry. Don't build a single bloated registry for everything. Build multiple registry via environment. So, yeah, we could switch, I guess. Yeah.
Deploy images, yes. After you have built all these steps, who of you built all these steps? Who is in production? Who work for a bigger enterprise? Nobody? Okay. Someone. You're all on playground. If you don't do that, what we are explaining here, then you're not safe. We learned it very hard. We set up trainings and so from infrastructure completely automatically. And if you trust services in the internet that you can download something, then it's a hard time in your night before your training. And I don't like those nights. And I think if you have a DDoS attack and you can rebuild all your things where other services in the internet have also a DDoS attack, and you can download your images or reproduce that, then you are offline. You are in production? Who is really in production? Yeah, if an aggressive attacker have it on you, then you go down. what we do on deploy stage, after all these steps, we have trusted images. We use Docker Compose for Docker swarming deployments and services, or on a normal engine deployment for some smaller setups. And in Kubernetes, we use Helm. Helm is a templating engine that you can deploy a complete setup of resources of Kubernetes in one time, and you can customize it on your special environment with some templating variables on it. And what deployment strategies we use? The first thing, the easy thing that we all like is recreate it. It is very trusting, normal things that we do. We drop down the current version of the software, do something with the databases, and recreate it with the new versions and check that. That is the normal way. What we also do is sometimes with stateless services ramp up these roll it, what we've seen in the Kubernetes stuff is the deployment that we start a new version, drop one of the processes of the old versions, and then again, and after this process we're replacing the complete version A to B. And the blue-green deployment, we deploy it together, two versions, compatibility mode, and if we say, okay, the new green version is really, really good, then we drop all the blues. And we have canary deployment that is a subset of users. We switch the traffic, some cookies or so on it, or marketing or market on the traffic, and roll down some of the user traffic to special instances and test with a subset of the users in that. But on really these canary deployments, you must have a more configurable load balancer that's a normal Kubernetes or so setup. So you have not the chance to mark some deployments. It's really stateless. It is simple cases for Docker swarming or Kubernetes. If you set up a canary deployment, you need a special load balancer that have these features. It's not the standard. A/B testing. You are not have it for a limited time, but it needs more time to test that. To have really two setups of your application versions with more different features, and a subset of your users go to special conditions to these traffic, and you start that, and then you can have a colorized version, not A/B. You have 10 versions in productions with different users. And sometimes on traffic you have shadowing. You shadow your traffic. You say, okay, I have a request and do it to a new version and test this new version, but I don't respond to the user directly. I want only test that the feature is going well in the new versions. And some messaging systems are in between that in the normal way. But if you have complex deployments like this, you need a lot of more help to your infrastructure. And some of the friends, container solutions, have made the matrix and say, okay, what deployment impact you? Can you roll back that, read it? And I think shadow deployment is only for very, very professional users. The deployment that we also do is recreate it or ramp up it or blue-green. But if you use blue-green, it can be a complex time. Cloud cost, you need a lot of more infrastructure in your team. You must have an automatic way to create new instances and so to have that and drop that and control these processes. It can be complex. That is a good thing. But what you need really on deployment is best practice on runtime. Don't add security issues. If you only can deploy your containers with read-only file system, aggressor cannot change files. It's very easy with containers. Or limit memory and CPU usage that a bomb of shell cannot drop your complete cluster. Passing credential and secret, don't inject it. User a vault as example, and give you container credentials and then load the real secrets in your software is a good practice. Drop unused capabilities on the Linux layer. If you don't need some capabilities to change mod or whatever it is, drop it. You must scan your images. If you have it in production, and you must scan all your versions that you used in your production systems to detect some possibilities that your software have an evil time. And use container firewalls like NuVector firewalling. The normal way containers can talk to all together, but drop that. Have a namespace and make a clear policy which container can communicate with the others. And it's very complicated in a container way. You have a dynamic, it's not static. You must build a system that on a node, I detect a new version of this pod that can communicate with some others, and then you are, before you the container environment, the Kubernetes environment, create your pod, you must establish your policies on this host. And don't use root as your processes. That is the default for the most containers that you can download from the hub. We have a checklist, a very simple one, for secure your trust. Check your licenses if you are working on an enterprise. You can ask you really have some dependencies from outside, and is in these dependencies some vulnerabilities? Is the newest version the best? That is one of the really, really complicated question. And use these newest versions of things, other things. Traversal. You have an active process, a human-based process to control all these dependencies, and really think about that. And you detect really new versions. If you're looking on the internet, a lot of guys say, "Oh, I have sell a new version," but they sell it in a package system like PHP or Ruby or Java or GitHub or source code like Go. And it's not so easy to detect these new versions and reflect that in their own software. And you must have clever processes, small, tiny scripts to route to detect that a new version is from whatever is on place in the world. Do you have an active process to manage these new versions? If you have a human that really interesting to have a new version in production, or say the management, no, it's running. We have an interesting discussion with Niklas the last week, and we wrote a mind map. What are the horrible picture is what we can present in this last talk, and that is a very small part that we discussed. But I hope you can help us to fulfill this mind map in these weeks and talk with us about what are topics to get a secure container supply chain. That is a really interesting item. And what is really needed in your use cases and what is very sophisticated. And now we offer trainings, discuss with us, and now open the door for questions.